Tonight's event is being hosted by Krishna-Pillay. Chris has a background in science and is one of Australia's most prominent science communicators and performers. His writing and performing credits include Howard Florey, A Tale of Tall Poppies, Somnium, Precoital, Dante's Laboratory, and the Great Big Science Gig, which I think is on at the moment, isn't it? Well, not right now, but otherwise, you're in trouble, to name a few. Over the past 20 years, Chris has performed extensively throughout Australia and internationally. More information on Chris's stellar career and our panellists as well can be found in the biographies in your programs, in your satchels. So please put your hands together and welcome our host for this evening, Chris Krishna-Pillay.
Thank you, Amanda. Welcome, folks. That was nice whooping, by the way, there. I don't believe you meant it, but I'm glad you did it. I'm nothing if not a fragile ego. I need to explain a couple of important things for you. We're going to take you through a couple of presentation things just quickly so we can get our heads around stuff. Before we do that, though, there's a couple of rules that I think we need to, just know and abide by on fear of pain. This is a discussion, okay? It's actually called a dinner discussion because we want to talk about stuff. But, you know, it's like, imagine if you will that, I think we can treat this like a first date, okay? We all want to impress each other. We want to have a really good time, but you don't want to do anything embarrassing, okay? So the guideline I would give you, the things I've noted here, right, we've sorted the phones out, so they're on silent. So you're sitting there opposite the table on your first date and suddenly your leg starts to vibrate. Well, that's weird, right? Okay? But it's better than actually answering it and talking to your ex-girlfriend. Trust me on that. When it's time to be talking and stuff, by all means, we'll have hands in the air because we have got roaming microphone people, so we'll get to you with those. So if you want to say something or ask a question, wave your hand at me and I'll get someone to you as quickly as possible. We'll give you a couple of minutes. We don't want to go on and on and on because we will have, I suspect, lots of people who want to say things and we want to make sure we get around as many as possible. We also have a live forum from which there are already loads of questions that have been coming in over the last little while. There'll be tweets coming up as well, so we're going to try and feed as much of that into the conversation live tonight as we possibly can. Please be nice to people. Okay, we're all friends here, right? Hello, what's your name?
Rick.
Oh my God, he's terrifying. Okay, this is... But we're all friends, right? Okay, yeah. Okay, good. Possibly a bad example. Anyway, so my point is, be nice to each other. Don't get aggro. Don't be nasty. The whole joy of tonight is that we're all in this together and we get to do something that is quite a rare opportunity and we should take the opportunity while we can. My advice to you, frankly, is have fun. If you can walk away from tonight feeling like you've done something that was enjoyable and informative, then I think you should be, proud, frankly, as well as tickle pink. Now, this is to do with food security. That's the premise that we're coming at this entire discussion about. So it's important for us to understand or at least have some collective experience as to what that actually means and why we think that it is any kind of issue at all. So we have a very short video to show you here and that will hopefully get us to a starting point.
The hidden GFC. The world might be in the process of rebounding from the global financial crisis, but did you know that we're experiencing another GFC? The global food crisis. This food crisis is due to factors including population growth, decreasing land and resources like fuel and water, and the ways we use and store food. Changing climatic conditions also affect the amount of food available. Many experts are predicting that this crisis will become worse in the next 40 years. This problem is frequently called food security. So what is food security? The Food and Agriculture Organization defines food security as being a state when all people at all times have physical and economic access to sufficient, safe and nutritious food to meet their dietary needs and food preferences for an active and healthy life. In some countries, food shortages have already caused riots, like those seen in Tunisia and Algeria, and there are often times of food insecurity even in countries like Australia or Japan. These are after interruptions to supply from natural disasters, like cyclones and earthquakes, or even droughts. Broadly, there are five main issues that we as a society need to address if there is to be global food security. Availability. Is there enough food to feed the population of the world? Accessibility. Does everyone have access to enough food every day? Acceptability. Does the food available meet cultural requirements? Adequacy. Is the food of sufficient quality and does it include all the nutrient requirements? Stability of source. Is it readily and always available? In Australia, we produce enough food for about 60 million people, but we only have 22 million people at the moment. Well, what's the problem then? There are three main reasons for Australia to be concerned about food security. The first is food availability. Floods, cyclones and droughts cause significant interruptions to food supply, and these result in big increases in price which affect people's quality of life. As more and more of the weekly income is spent on the grocery bill, less is available for other necessities and lifestyle purchases. The second reason is that Australian society is becoming increasingly urbanised. This means that the general population is becoming disconnected from the land and the way that food is produced. The way Australians see food and their attitudes towards it are affecting food security. Thirdly, Australia has a responsibility to lend a helping hand with global food supplies. Global food productivity needs to be increased by about 50% above the current levels in the next 40 years, and this needs to be done in changing climatic conditions. So there's lots of work to be done, but where do we start? We can start by recognising the importance of the food industry, which nowadays is very sophisticated and scientific. Australia has great technical skills to offer other countries. We need to build on these strengths by encouraging training and careers in agriculture to ensure ongoing research, collaboration and development. We also need to respect food. We need to understand what it takes to produce it and reduce our wastage of it. Start by growing your own veggie patch. We also need to improve the yield of our crops to ensure that we can meet global food demands. Increases in yields can be gained by a number of methods. Improvements in traditional plant breeding techniques, new technologies like genetic modification, selective breeding using DNA markers, and resource management will help to get more food from fewer inputs. We essentially need to do more with less. Improvements in our attitudes, plant breeding techniques, and accepting our responsibility to help ensure global food security will allow Australia to play a role in meeting the demands of a world population that is expected to be over 9 billion in the next 40 years.
The other thing that I think I want to try and get sorted out before we get to meet the panel, who I think are doing a very good job of not looking awkward. But and that's good, but without doing anything actively or saying anything, if you want to make them feel awkward, just look strangely at them, feel free, because it is a very long time to sit in an exalted position without... And these are people who are used to saying stuff too. We couldn't shut them up over dinner, so I'm loving this moment of passive-aggressive power that we have. The other thing that I want to try and get a level playing field about as quickly as we can before we get to the panel is the science behind this stuff. So what do we actually know? What don't we know? Where are we at? What's the future potentially? All that kind of caper. To run you through a brief description of those kinds of issues before we get hoed into the discussion in earnest, will you please welcome Monica Ogierman.
Thanks, Chris. Hello. Oh. All right. Welcome, everybody, to tonight's National Science Week event. So we can all engage in tonight's topic, I will go through a little bit of the background science. I promise it won't hurt, but it's a National Science Week event. It has to be done. Okay, so we're going to talk tonight about genetic modification, also known as GM, in agriculture and the role it's going to play in food security. Well, should GM be used? At the end of the evening, you'll get to vote. There's a slip on everyone's table. We're going to discuss three main cereal crops shown here, our wheat, barley and our rice. Why? One very simple reason. These grains become the food we know and love. You may not recognise them, but wheat becomes our breads, our pasta and our biscuits and even grain waves. Barley becomes something extremely important, our beer. And the malt goes into sweets. Rice is pretty self-explanatory. But more importantly, about half the world's population depends on rice for food, and about a third depends on wheat. So these are quite important crops. So a good place to start with the science is DNA. You can see the double helix, which is pretty famous now, twirling around. DNA is found in every living thing. Now, that includes all the food we eat, whether you're a vegetarian or you eat meat or you like your pulses and legumes. Now, that helix can't actually be seen with the naked eye because it's so small. And it's so small you can't actually even see it under a microscope. This is why it's called molecular. And DNA is often referred to as the molecule of life. It sounds dramatic, but it's because it contains all the instructions, all the information needed to make a living being. Now, DNA contains genes, shown here is a small part of the DNA, so it codes for a function or a trait. So what I mean by that is, say, blue eyes or brown hair or disease tolerance if you happen to be a wheat plant. Now, how does the code actually work? Amazingly, it's only four building blocks that form the code in DNA, shown here. Now, that's for all DNA, regardless of whether, again, you're an insect or a human and so on. How on earth can we get so much diversity if it's only four building blocks? What actually happens is these building blocks are repeated and they're linked together in really long chains which form the DNA, and they also like to pair up. Now, what's really important here is the order. The order of those building blocks will determine the code. It will determine, is that a gene? What does it encode for? That gives us so much diversity. It's now possible to read the DNA code, and we found some interesting things I thought I'd share with you tonight. This is how related you are, and it's not meant to be an insult, to a chimpanzee, 95%. I think some of my friends might be a little bit higher than that. Mouse, 80%. Fruit fly, cabbage, my favourite. Not very flattering. Now, the important thing about DNA is that it is passed on from generation to generation. It's what we inherit from our parents, whether we like it or not. So what we are talking about is reproduction. And hopefully you're all familiar with how this works with humans. But what you may not need to know, and what you need to know, is, plants actually do it too. They sexually reproduce. And I'm sorry if this is too graphically explicit. Sexual reproduction of a plant, just look away if you're finding it okay. There is such a thing as plant breeding. Now, how does this work? It works in a similar way to the way we domesticate our cats and our dogs. We take two parents with traits that we like, we cross them together, and we select the best offspring. So here we go with plants. We've got parent one, parent two. Now, like all parents, they've got their good points and they've got their bad points. Parent one, let's say, produces a lot of grains, which equals a lot of food. Farmers are happy, we're happy. But it doesn't grow well in a drought. Now let's take parent two. Opposites attract. Doesn't produce many grains, but it can grow in a drought. So a plant breeder is going to cross those together and select for offspring which have inherited the best traits from both parents. Now you'll see in that picture there, there is a pair of tweezers and you can see some fingers, so this requires human intervention. I guess it's like artificial insemination in the plant world. Now, this sort of plant breeding is done with plants within the same species. So plant breeding in one form or another has been done for about 10,000 years and has been used to generate new plant varieties as the need arises. But now enter DNA. Gene technology that uses the DNA that is naturally occurring in the plant is now used in plant breeding. This is used to make the process more efficient and more precise. One technique uses something called a molecular marker. As the name suggests, molecular, teeny-weeny. So there's a part of the DNA that acts like a little red flag which tells the plant breeder which plants has the gene of interest. Now, these plants, even though this is gene technology, these plants are not genetically modified. Now, you remember I said earlier that all DNA from all living things can be broken down to four building blocks. Because of that, it is now possible to do genetic modification, GM, which is what you're here to discuss tonight. It's a technique where, in the laboratory, the genetic material of organisms is altered. Now, this is a very simple form of how it works. So the scientists will isolate the DNA, which has the gene of interest. They'll make a copy, and then they'll use little molecular scissors to cut out that gene and paste it into the plant of interest. So this plant is genetically modified. Genes can be accessed from other species. It doesn't rely on reproduction. So that's it. Hopefully that wasn't too bad. Hopefully it helped. I'm going to hand you back to Chris. Please enjoy the discussion. Thanks.
Yes, give it up. Wow, that's giving it up. Okay. Don't peek too early. That's fine.